And while we wait for the next session to start, this is another very interesting session that we're going to start. It's the SME panel, Extreme Customer Centricity in the Digital Age. We'll request you to kindly remain seated. We will do a, we'll take a couple of minutes to do the setup. And in the meanwhile, a mention about the sponsors for the event. Infocom 2019 Delhi is supported by Ministry of Electronics and IT, Government of India, Digital India Plan, and NEGD. Partner states, governments of Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, and Jharkhand, co-host STPI, Software Technology Parks of India, banking partner Punjab National Bank, associate partners Jharkhand Agency for Promotion of Information Technology, Dot One Solutions and 4C Plus, exchange partner BSE SME, SME partner FISME, and TV partner ABP News. May I request all our delegates present here to kindly remain seated. We are going to start with a very, very interesting panel discussion. And straight after that, we'll have the telecom connectivity in remote areas using innovative green power. And tonight's spotlight session is going to be very interesting for all of you. It's Accelerate Achieving Excellence Together. And after that, we're going to have a CIO panel, The Future of Data Science, Machine Learning, and AI. I hope you're connecting with us on social media. We are present on Facebook, on Twitter, on LinkedIn. Please give us your valuable inputs, your stories, your pictures, everything, whatever you have been experiencing in Infocom Delhi 2019, do share with us. Our hashtags are Infocom Delhi 2019 and hashtag winning in this VUCA world and hashtag in a VUCA world. On Facebook, we are present as Infocom Connect. On Twitter, with the handle Infocom Connect. On LinkedIn, as ABP Infocom. And on YouTube, as Infocom Connect. And dear delegates, ladies and gentlemen, we will start off with our next session, the SME panel, Extreme Customer Centricity in the Digital Age. And I will take this opportunity to welcome and introduce the panelists and the chairperson and moderator. I would like to request our first panelist, Mr. Anand Chari, Deputy General Manager, SME Development, BSE Limited, to kindly come on stage and take his seat. Please give a round of applause to him. Mr. Anand Chari is Deputy General Manager, SME Business Development at BSE, Asia's first and oldest stock exchange. In his professional journey of more than two decades in the BFSI sector, Mr. Anand Chari has handled various positions in retail sales, institutional sales, channel development, and branch network management. It's my privilege to welcome you, sir. Our next panelist for this session is Mr. Sanjay Hiranandani, CEO and Managing Partner, Dot One Solutions. May I request you to take your seat on the dais, sir? Mr. Sanjay Hiranandani is a chartered accountant and has experience of more than 29 years in the industry. He has held leadership positions in large multinational organizations. He has also been an entrepreneur himself in the past as well and has been instrumental in building startup organizations. He loves sports and believes that business often compares with the unscripted world of sports. It's my privilege to welcome you, sir. Our next panelist is Mr. Mohit Pande, Senior Vice President and Co-Founder, Linear Square Private Limited. May I request you to take your seat on the dais? And a round of applause for him, please. Mr. Pande is the former Country Manager, India, Google Cloud. Prior to Google, Mr. Mohit held senior leadership roles with Microsoft in India and Southeast Asia. He's a well-known tech industry leader across India and Southeast Asia. He has extensive experience working across the tech and digital landscape, building businesses and leading high-performing teams across India and Southeast Asia. In his last role, Mr. Mohit founded and led the cloud business for Google in India. It's my privilege to welcome you, sir. Our next panelist is Mr. Ravi Sood, Central Executive Committee Member, FISME. May I request you, sir, to kindly come onto the dais and take your seat. Mr. Ravi Sood. He's here. Please put your hands together for Mr. Ravi Sood as I welcome him onto the dais to take his seat. Mr. Ravi Sood is a first-generation entrepreneur and has been instrumental in the setting up of a manufacturing unit under the name and style of Neeraj Industries for manufacturing precision-turned components. He has been instrumental in skillfully steering his firm on a carefully planned path, having a mix of expansion, diversification, and modernization, resulting into creation of one of its kind manufacturing facility. Warm welcome, sir. Our next panelist for this session is Mr. Umesh Gupta, President, Network of ICT Entrepreneurs and Enterprises. May I request you, sir, to kindly come forward and take your seat. Mr. Gupta is a serial technology entrepreneur with over 20 years of experience in managing tech consulting practices, operating multi-million dollar companies, building innovative technology products, and negotiating deal and interacting with Fortune 500 international and domestic clients. And these are some of his forte. It's my privilege to welcome you, sir. And our chairperson and moderator for this session is Mr. Sudhir Aggarwal, Chief Strategy Officer, Silver Touch Technologies Limited, Managing Partner, IB Platform, LLP. May I request you, sir, to kindly come forward and take your seat. Some of the industry recognitions that Mr. Sudhir Aggarwal has to his name is IT Industry Leader, named by eGov in Jan 2010, Good Governance National Technology Leadership Award 2010, he was nominated for that, advisor member, Future Skills Stone, Amity Online, and more. And I will now hand over the session to Mr. Sudhir Aggarwal, who's going to be the chairman and the moderator for this session. Sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So, welcome all my fellow panelists. I think the good thing is we have a very diverse, experience and expertise in our fellow panels. So I'm sure we are going to have interesting discussion and talking points for everyone. So with my fellow panelists, I'll just seek the permission. What I'll do, I'll try to put a perspective to the theme, and then I think each of us can contribute to that. Will that be fair? Thank you, sir. So first thing, when we are saying customer centricity, I would like to expand it to stakeholder centricity. Because when today you say digital and you say customer, unless you are doing 360 degree, it is not alone. So you have to take all the stakeholders along with you. So I'm saying customer centricity not. And second, when we say customer centricity and digital, I think it has to be led from the top. Now it is something which cannot be delegated. It has to be led from the top because it has a lot of nuances, a lot of challenges in that. And this has to be viewed like a transformation perspective rather than incremental perspective. Now, the journey we can always define that, what is the pace, what is the, phases. But it has to be 360 and holistic in nature. And it covers all your, be it your people, your process, everything. It covers all of them. And obviously today, when we say technology, digital, it is the technology disruptions, which are actually causing the whole thing. So when we are saying technology disruption, we need to understand that. And we need to have the capacity to adapt that also. So at this point, if I just stop my intro part or the initial intervention, I would request each of the fellow panelists to, maybe in 1.5 to 2 minutes, each of you, just put your perspective across that what are your thoughts to the theme of the session today. So Mr. Anand, can we start with you?
Thank you, everyone. And good afternoon to all the dignitaries on the dais, along with me and off the dais. And thanks India Infocom and Indraneel for giving us this opportunity for showcasing our platform also. I can give you a perspective from the SME platform, what I represent, Bombay Stock Exchange. So we could really see that before our session, we had Velumini talking about the valuation and listing thing. You made my job very easy that the valuation can happen into the market. So what, as a promoter gets into this listing and SME platform is that as a platform what we have, they get the maximum visibility which is not available to them because they have been working into the smaller area and across India. And secondly, what they get is that they can have a balance sheet which is balanced between debt and equity. Secondly, you can interact with a lot of new customers which is not there available to them unless they are getting listed because they are not visible. They can create credibility in front of the bankers because the balance sheet is also very strong. Because the most of the people, they take loans, mostly it is skewed towards debt. It is more of a servicing part, they have been troubled. So when they have a balance sheet which is having equity and debt, it makes easier for them to take more loans or it gets in balanced. Secondary, later on stage, they can mortgage these shares and probably take the loans, because mostly they have mortgaged everything till the time they have been taking loans, they have been running the show. It becomes easier for them to start the business once again with the equity market also. It's very easier for them to get the funding, and it has become very easy that it takes 3 months for you to get the company listed. Within 7 years, we have amassed almost 307th company getting listed today in Ahmedabad, and which has created a valuation of 18,000 crores. And all out of those 307 companies, almost 65 companies have migrated to the main board. And the fund raised across these 307 companies has been 3,230 crores. So probably I feel the small SME companies, the promoters who are sitting over here, this is the platform, you can say as a digital, probably as a regulator, I can put it across that. It's a very easy thing. The myths, whatever you have it in your mind, probably we can have it one-to-one question answers and later on stage. Thank you.
Thanks, wonderful. That's great. And I think stock exchange, because I'm also experiencing these days, when especially SME, they go public, I think they go through a very different world. And they go through all the unknown, untested waters. And I think they take a lot of time to come through that. So in a later part, maybe you can share some of that. Sanjay?
Right. Good afternoon, everyone. I must admit, I'm still reeling from goosebumps of the previous session. Yes. I must admit, yeah, it was just absolutely fantastic. One of the best sessions I've ever attended. And as I said, I think it's going to be difficult to keep pace with what happened at that session, but we'll try our best. So I have a take on the fact that we are sitting over here in a panel, which of course is going to talk about extreme customer centricity, but we'll come to that in a few minutes. But the fact that this panel is slated as an SME panel, I have a take on that. So while a lot of people who are representing large organizations refer to the small and medium enterprises as SME, I have my own, if I may say so, objections on that. Because I do believe instead of referring to them as SME, you should probably refer to them where the enterprise is equal to the entrepreneur. Can you think of going and calling on a CEO or somebody who set up an enterprise with all the blood, sweat and toil that it takes to set up an enterprise, and you say, hey, I'm representing so-and-so organization, and I'm over here because I represent the SME segment. He'll say, what the hell are you talking about? Yeah, that's number one. Number two, In this segment, it's very difficult to distinguish between the enterprise and the entrepreneur. Yeah? So there's a very thin dividing line between the entire enterprise and the entrepreneur, or the entrepreneur and the enterprise. So that's my take on SME as a terminology. I do believe it would be better christened as enterprise equal to entrepreneur, and we'll talk more about that as we move along.
So even if you look at even in the large organizations, I think even they land up creating SMEs inside, because when you are looking at any new transformation, you know, they have to identify internal SMEs. The only difference is an SME always has a much larger risk-taking ability and capability, while people, what the previous speaker again said, you know, the people within large organization, even when they try to work like a task force or SME, they are still protected. They are on a protected turf. So, Mohit.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's a privilege and an honor to be here amongst all of you and with the esteemed panel. Like you rightly said, I think it's tough to come after a charismatic speaker like Mr. Valerie. So, We'll try our best to keep it as interesting as possible. So I come from the technology world. You know, I am a startup entrepreneur myself, so I could be considered an SME in a lot of ways, you know, on what I'm doing. But I also come from the other side, where I was working for very large and esteemed organizations like Google. I worked in Google for a very long time, before that with Microsoft. So coming to this, this subject's very close to my heart because of two things. One is that today we are fortunate enough to be living in a world where technology is breaking all barriers. It's become all pervasive, and it has taken away the advantage which a large enterprise used to have compared to an SME. Earlier, the entry barriers to any kind of a business, you know, were very high for a small company to come and disrupt any industry. And that's what we saw till almost 1970s, 1980s. But as technology started developing, as mobile, internet, cloud, data, etc. has come in, and today a startup has got almost equal access to technology as a large enterprise does. And that's why you're seeing how it is the smaller enterprises which are really disrupting age-old business models which have been there. That's the whole Silicon Valley, that's the foundation of the Silicon Valley, or what India and other emerging markets have brought in as their competitive advantage. And the reason they're doing so is not just because they have access to great technology, but they are more agile and they are more customer focused. Large enterprises tend to figure that, okay, it's okay to kind of put profits before everything else, or to take a little bit while to respond to that one small customer query in the small town. But small enterprises are probably more agile. Every customer is important to them, and they do a much better job faster than a large enterprise. So in a lot of sense, I think technologies like AI, ML, data, cloud, etc. are enabling us to be customer centric. And what is your customer is also changing. So your customer is not just the end consumer, probably. Your distributor is your customer. Your retailer is your customer. Your employee is your customer. There's a war for talent. And hence, using technology to be able to focus on each one of them 100%, if you're not doing that, you are probably losing the race.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful, Mohit. And on the same note, if you look at, I think, natural gainer of digital world, if you really look at it, is MSME. Aaj agar Muradabad ka ek trader apna Amazon pe, if I say, maal bech sakta hai, Amazon ne aapke baju wale market ke jo ka jo trader hai, usko agar aap usne delivery channel banaya hai, it is all hats off to technology. So what they have done, two things. They have exploited the technology, and second, they have also brought the inclusiveness into the whole system. So that is where the technology, but the biggest challenge of technology is when the large organizations, even SME, they look at it. I think one thought process we have to change, instead of automating and adopting technologies, we have to do outside, look outside inside. We have to look at, what the world is wanting. Now, a lot of time, we may not even realize, but our ecosystem players are changing and their demands are changing. So continuous alignment like that is very, very critical to that. So Mr. Ravi.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for having me here. Well, I am no expert on the topic of today, the extreme customer centricity in digital world, but as I'm representing the industry, manufacturing industry, manufacturing sector of MSME on behalf of FISME, I will try and put forth before you their views. When I was first informed about this topic of today's discussion, the first thing that came to my mind are the famous quotes of Mahatma Gandhi, and I quote, "Customer is the most important visitor in our premises. He is not dependent on us, we are dependent on him. He is not an interruption in our work, he is the purpose of it. He is not an outsider in our business, he is a part of it. We are not doing any favor to him by serving him, and he is doing, in fact, a favor to us by giving us an opportunity to do so." These thoughts, first of all, they convey us that the world was aware of the customer importance even in the times of Gandhiji. With the advancement of technology, customer expectations have arisen many folds, and to the extent that a recent survey indicated that profits of an organization can rise as much as by 30% if it focuses on customer, being customer-centric. An example of this, I was coming by an Uber today. In good olden times, we used to hire a taxi, and we were prepared to wait for 30 minutes or even go to the, our nearby taxi stand, and we never cribbed. But today, if the Uber driver delays or the Ola driver delays by 5 minutes, we tend to get restless. So with each passing day, the expectations of customers are rising, and industry or the organization as a whole, and MSME in particular, have to rise to the expectations of the ever-increasing requirements of the customer. Now, one word that struck me in today's topic was extreme. Normally, the word extreme has negative connotations, but here, to my mind, it means it is to lay emphasis that you cannot overemphasize the importance of customer in today's world. Now, I want to say a word of caution that, in today's digital world, we have technology available with us, and so we have to be careful that we do not use this digital technology to hound or, browbeat the customer, but to give him a support without being visible. So that is the key to success, because if we hound him with, feedbacks or, SMSs or things like that, it is likely to create a opposite, action. Thank you.
Mr. Ravi. See, again, I think it happens like this. If I relate to the media industry, it's all self-regulation. So what you're saying is right, that, that there is a over, but then it is all about, over time it gets moderated, it's a self-learning, and that's how it evolves. So, Mr. Umesh, your initial comments, please.
Thank you, sir. One small complaint, sir. You put me at the end of a very illustrious panel, and there's not a whole lot left for me to say, isn't it? I mean, I have to not dig out words. Okay, thank you so much, but
sir,
I appreciate this.
I'll just take 30 seconds. Hum kabhi bhi presentation karne jaate hain, hum kehte hain ya to hume pehla banao ya last banao. Wo isliye ki pehle mein hum ya to agenda set karenge ya last mein sabko lapet lenge. So choice is yours, sir.
Sir, main lapetne walon mein se hu, lapetne walon mein se nahi, but thank you so much. I think following up after Mr. Velumini is not an easy thing, but usme se ek bahut achhi cheez ye hui hai, wo ye kehte hain ki aap lunch ke baad jo panel mein aate hain, wo मतलब कि उनकी ऑडियंस जो है वो काफ़ी बार सोती मिलती है तो वेलुमिनी जी ने इंश्योर किया कि एटलीस्ट यू नो वी हैव अ वेरी वाइब्रेंट ऑडियंस ओवर हियर सो थैंक हिम आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक हिम ही इज ऑल्सो टॉट मी अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट लेसन टुडे आई मीन यू नो सच ग्रेट पीपल दे टीच यू थिंग्स सो क्विकली देयर इज अ डिफरेंस बिटवीन कम्युनिकेशन एंड लैंग्वेज इजंट इट टुडे मिस्टर वेलुमिनी स्पोक इन सच अ स्ट्रॉन्ग साउथ इंडियन एक्सेंट इन अ नॉर्थ इंडियन प्लेस एंड ही स्पोक इन हिंदी ऑल्सो And he still managed to communicate better than most of us can do when we speak in Hindi or English together out here, right? In very refined language. So I think that's a great lesson. Coming to the topic for today. There's a lot to learn over here for me. So most of the times you see people who move from corporate world to the entrepreneurship. Mine is an opposite story. I've been an entrepreneur most of my life, and it is very recently I moved to the corporate world. And so I'm trying to see these two spectrums, and I'm trying to correlate it with what I'm seeing here. So I'm a guy from analytics background, been in analytics company, footed my own companies. And I could see very clearly that that digital interactions or digital media is an extremely important way to communicate with people, with your audience, right? And in this, because it is customer-centric thing we're talking about today, with your customers. But when I moved to this new company, which is supposedly the world's largest digital interactions company with more than nearly 100,000 employees and a $6 billion+ revenue, I realized when you talk about a company of this size be talking about digital interactions, how critical it is for them to be involved in that. And clearly the difference lies, while the similarities lies in digital interactions, the difference is, while as an SME, I will be focusing a lot more on the marketing and sales side of my pitch, where I get such a great opportunity to have an equalizer with even the large players, right? Because instead of the earlier times where where you had to have a face-to-face interaction all the time to try and market. Today, we get an opportunity to be faceless and yet, you know, be able to showcase our products or how good we are to a great, you know, media called digital interaction. But for my company where I work today, you know, the digital interaction is on the other side. So they use this medium, how not to increase a force, let's say, from 100,000 people to 250,000 people. Because instead of trying to go door to door to try and cater to customers or provide them services, today this company is able to use this so beautifully to be able to analyze information or be able to reach out to customers to be able to cater better to them and provide better service to them. And that's the beauty that lies in the digital interactions. And I'm sure we all understand digital interactions is primarily moving away from face-to-face interaction into trying to have some interface. In a country like ours, where you have 930 million people users of mobile devices, 60 million people using Facebook, 15 million people using Twitter and LinkedIn, it's a great opportunity. It's a great time to be in. I hope we can set the context here and move forward. Thank you, sir.
So like, you know, we spoke about our previous speaker spoke about the biggest salesperson because he's the second biggest. Now, the biggest salesperson is Mr. Modi, that's what is mentioned. So let me share one use case, how digital has made the difference. I can share with all of you around 3 years back or 3.5 years back, one advertisement got dropped from, radio. Based on my writing to PMO, to Mr. Modi, you know, through digital media. Now, as a biggest salesperson, he has been able to create a direct connect with the, you know, end person. Now, there was an ad about, you send photographs and video of the corrupt people. So I wrote, my perspective on that. Can you believe me, in 2 weeks, I got a message from PMO. Saying it has been sent to Home Minister. Next week, I learned from Home Minister office, it has been sent to Delhi Police Commissioner. And that particular week, that ad got withdrawn. Now, I'm saying that is the power of digital and customer centricity, because for him, we are the customers. So to me, this is a huge use case. So likewise, I will request all our fellow panelists, maybe Mohit to start with you. What is one of your experiences of either your customer, your partners, you would like to share about the customer centricity in the digital age?
Yeah. So I'd like to speak about, there are hundreds and thousands of use cases where, digital technologies have disrupted, very common notions of how we should interact with customers. But I'll take a example of what we are doing in my current company, Linear Squared, where we build B2B solutions using machine learning and artificial intelligence. So what we do today for consumer-focused companies is that one of the big things for any business is customer churn. So, no matter how much of money you spend to acquire customers, if you're not able to retain them, it's a big loss. And today, most of the people do not have any idea about what makes a customer come back. We run this for food and beverage businesses like the pizza businesses, etc. We run this for telcos. Typically, how people look at customer churn is that you look at your last 30 days interactions. If they've not, interacted with you, they're probably churning, and then you go to them. But the problem is, like you just mentioned, that we get bombarded with SMSs that, let's say if it's a pizza company, you get bombarded with SMSs that, come every Wednesday and have a 1-for-2 offer, even though I might not be a pizza owner, or my son must be going, but he's given my phone number there. So what we do using some machine learning, and this is all data from the small outlet which is serving that pizza, is to kind of figure out and give them a indication of which are the customers who are likely to churn. And this is based on their previous buying habits, eating habits, demographic of that area, and telling them that, okay, out of your 10,000 customers, these 500 are likely to churn, or they should come back this week. But if they don't, this is the reason he might not come back, and this is the reason she might not come back. And hence, you might want to send a specific offer to this person and a specific offer to this person, rather than spam everyone for that. And that kind of first does a better use of your advertising and promotion budgets, and second, it's more relevant to the end customer. That's a small example of what we're trying to build there, and we've seen some huge amount of successes using that.
And I think technologies like AI are just coming to, you know, very handy.
Absolutely, and they're going to disrupt many, many traditional ways of doing business, for sure.
Absolutely, because AI is one which is, you know, like beating the people now, because it has a self-learning attitude, if I may say that. And then, you know, it helps you.
And it doesn't have biases. Oh, well, it can, but it does usually doesn't.
And another thing, I think in today's time, when the options are too many for the consumer, the times are gone, you know, when white Maruti, red Maruti with Tatkal 30,000, those days are over. So today, when you have so much of variety all over, and customer loyalties are actually taking hit. So I think it's also more important that we have to continuously to be extreme customer, you know, centric. So Mr. Anand, would you like to put your perspective on this? You know, with your experience, some of your experience of, you know, in your domain, where customer centricity, for you, obviously, the investors, the people who go IPO, they do. They are your customers.
Yeah, I'm just taking a cue from Ravi Sood, who talked about Mahatma Gandhiji and customer-centric. Before 7 years back, when we started this platform in 2012-13 March, earlier the promoters who wanted the fund, they used to come to the stock exchange, they used to get listed. And after 2012, we have gone to the promoters and we have been promoting this. Till date, we have done more than 1,800 events individually. My the head and the startup and BSE head, Ajit Thakur, who was supposed to be there, and probably I'm just replacing him for the event. He has individually met more than 28,000 promoters in last 2.5 years of my existence in Bombay Stock Exchange. Individually, across India, this is my third session over there in India Infocom, I would have met personally 3,000 promoters. So today, when we talk about the customer-centric things, we have been doing it. And the digital, what we are talking about, we have done everything online platform. The promoters who have got listed, they have to do the compliance online. We are given the logins and ID over there. They can put them, everything uploaded on the systems. Probably it takes few seconds for them to get them uploaded and they can be doing the compliance automatically. So if you talk about the customers and all, 7 years back, we have got a lot of company coming up, like a 10 crores company, having a profit of 75 lakhs got listed. Today they are doing a business of 80 crores and net profit of more than 28 crores. So the things have grown very large, as Velimini said almost 10-15 minutes back. I'm really on with him that the valuation part, what he spoke about, which he came to know when he got listed, can happen, and probably I would request all the promoters who are sitting over here and listening to us, probably come forward and do the things, because we have been able to reach out to the people in 7 years, 1,800 events. Even I have done in last 2 years, more than 50 events I have been approaching across India. We want them to come forward a little bit more, because individually how many people we can reach out. So we try to do through digital media, participating like a seminars like this, and we would like to do more events also along with India Infocom, and probably with dignitaries along with us. We would require a lot of people are there along with me sitting over there who are the promoters. Probably we would like to be there part of the next session whenever we do it. Thanks a lot.
Mr. Umesh. Before, you know, you go social and, you know, abuse and accuse me, you to continue to keep you last, I think now is the time. So one of your experiences of, you know, where digital has, changed the customer centricity perspective, or has demanded and somebody has not responded. So either a good case or a bad case.
So I'd like to give two instances, if with your permission, in the same amount of time. Okay. So one will be as an entrepreneur. So we are into analytics, and quite clearly, we have big players in the industry who are miles and miles ahead of us by way of headcount and by way of their marketing strategies. And the marketing budgets are more than our product budgets, right? So the whole year's expenses. So it was a tough one to do that. But then when we analyze it, I'm talking about 3 years back, 4 years back, when digital marketing and et cetera was just coming into being. When we did a research, it turned out that for Google AdWords, they say that for every dollar that anybody puts on an average, you get $2 back. And that was a very, you know, interesting statistics for us. And then of course, you know, through AdWords, you have to be in the first page, because in the first page, you get 52% better chances of success than you get in any other page, all the other pages put together. So we, so instead of trying to get more people in, we clearly got more, we clearly tried to invest more in digital marketing, that is interaction through digital media, both for Google and for LinkedIn, because again, you know, our key market was, you know, LinkedIn, it was in LinkedIn. And we got some really good results because I think we got better success through that in marketing than we could have got by having, you know, 10 people on the road, because eventually we would be, geographically, we would be restricted. This way we could reach across the globe, because actually the whole world was a market for a product like ours. That was one example. The second, so where I'm working right now, it's very interesting, you know, so we work, I look after, apart from analytics, I look after a vertical where we do a lot of government payments. So that government payments is very different here. It's more like the subsidies that the government gives to its people, to the citizens or the residents of that state or the federal government. So when you talk about US, you're talking about practically 350, 400 million people being impacted by anything that is being done by government. So you have things like for women, you will give some subsidies. For children, you will give some subsidies. For child support, for economically weaker sections. And while initially, earlier, it used to be very difficult to try and give these subsidies because it had to be done physically. But of late, we started adding mobility and we started adding the online processing. So that we're talking about the Amazons and others of the world. And it's jumped like crazy. You're talking about interactions out here which have quadrupled probably in just 1 year's time, and how easily the customer can now, while traveling in his bus or, you know, or metro or something, is able to go ahead and access these things and get the things delivered to his house. So I can see both these sites playing up extremely well through the digital interactions.
Wonderful, wonderful, sir. And at least when you are giving some government examples, I still, my favorite is, you know, passport. 20 years back, 10 rupay ka passport form, travel agent say, so, 100 रुपए में मिलता था इस कमिटमेंट पे कि 2000 रुपए मुझे देके मेरे थ्रू अप्लाई करोगे. सो वी हैव मूव्ड फ्रॉम दैट टाइम टू आप रात को 11 बजे बिस्तर में बैठ के पासपोर्ट फॉर्म भरिए, आप डॉक्यूमेंट अपलोड कीजिए और आप 15 मिनट पहले जाके अपना पासपोर्ट अप्लाई कर दीजिए. संजय,
राइट, सो आई कांट हेल्प बट कीप गोइंग बैक टू द प्रीवियस सेशन ऑफ मिस्टर वेलुमणि. एंड वन थिंग दैट आई लर्नड आउट ऑफ हिज सेशन वाज यू गॉट टू बी अ स्टोरी टेलर. So I'm going to try and narrate two stories. One, a real life incident that happened just 9 days ago, which was an example of complete extreme customer uncentricity, and a story that I've picked up through the digital media of customer extreme centricity. So this was 2nd of July, only 9 days ago. I happened to be in Kolkata and was returning back to Mumbai on a day where Mumbai had downpoured a lot. There was complete deluge in Mumbai. Those who've been to Mumbai would know that at least once in a year or twice in a year, you have the city that's paralyzed. And it happened on that particular day, which was 2nd of July. I'm not going to name the airline, but I was flying by a particular airline which was supposed to leave from Kolkata for Mumbai at 7 p.m. So anybody who's catching a 7 p.m. flight would reach the airport around 5:30 or so. I reached the airport and found out that my flight is delayed to 12:30 in the night. No complaints, because you can't complain about the weather. No, nobody is to be faulted on that. Sat down in the lounge. Fortunately, India-Bangladesh World Cup match was on, so watched it. Around 12:30, the boarding announcement came, and I found that we were to take the coach and go to the aircraft. It was also raining in Kolkata. And I thought to myself straight away that perhaps the airline could have done better over here. You know, given us a proper entry into the aircraft through the aero bridge, but you're still going through the coach. Again, I thought, let's leave it to the extreme conditions that have happened, so people have not understood what they've got to do. Got into the aircraft, got into the seat, the plane took off, and the lady came to serve the food. And when she came to our row, I was with a colleague of mine. We gave our boarding passes, and she said, we've got non-veg enlisted for both of y'all. Here's your dish. And she gave the non-veg dish to my colleague also. And she said, sorry, there's a mistake. I'm a vegetarian. So can you give me a vegetarian dish, please? So she looked at her list and said, no, but you've been listed over here as a non-vegetarian. So there was an argument that was about to take place. I said, hold on, do you have a spare dish? She said, yes, I do, but I'm not allowed to swap. I said, this is under dire circumstances where you've had a customer waiting at the airport for 7 hours or 6 to 7 hours. You can make an exception. That was an example of complete customer uncentricity. Now move to a situation which I picked up on digital media, where you all must have heard of Guy Kawasaki, who was one of the founders of Apple, and Richard Branson happened to be participating in a panel like this somewhere in Japan a few years ago. And during the panel discussions, or just before the panel discussion, Richard Branson asked Guy Kawasaki. So I presume you flew all the way from here by Virgin Atlantic. So I said, no, I flew United Airlines. So he said, why would you do that? Why haven't you flown Virgin? So he said, well, I'm platinum card holder on United. I get all the privileges. I get the upgrades. Everything's taken care of, etc., etc., etc. Why should I move to Virgin? So Richard Branson took out his kerchief in a panel discussion like this and said, do they polish your shoes? And he actually polished his shoes in front of everybody. And he said, this is the service you will get should you fly Virgin. And he converted Guy Kawasaki from a United flyer to a Virgin Atlantic flyer. That is complete extreme customer centricity. That is it.
And, yeah? And Sanjay, that is from the leadership.
Absolutely. And that's what that's
that
what,
is from Lennon the leadership.
Said, yeah?
You
yeah.
cannot tell others to do it Got for it. You. Got you it. Cannot delegate. You have to lead by example. When you say change, it brings a lot of inconvenience, a lot of, you know, pushback. First, you have to accept and then lead by example.
True.
Wonderful, wonderful True. Example. True. And Sanjay, just to add the same thing what you said, last week my son was also flying into Mumbai from Delhi and he didn't book, you know, book the meal. Now, he asked for the meal, regular meal. She said, "Ke, you can buy sandwiches, but I can't sell you this meal." No, that poor fellow was saying, "Arre, mere ko madam, wo de do." Uske piche bachcha baitha tha. Family baithi thi, bachcha baitha tha. That lady continued to say no, and she only pushed them to have sandwiches. So that is, you know, but these industries, they don't change. You know, they are in the wrong myth.
No, I think the bigger you become as an organization, and this is not to belittle organizations that have grown. Don't get me wrong. I've worked for multi-billion dollar organizations, had leadership positions. I'm now part of a startup journey. But I think as organizations grow or as entities grow, you become more internalized than externalized. Yeah, that's the problem. And I'm under no illusion that nowhere in big companies do you have boardroom sessions where somebody at the top is talking about customer centricity to his people. No way. It doesn't happen.
And,
yeah?
And even if they're talking, they're only talking.
Yeah, exactly.
They don't mean it.
Exactly.
Mr. Ravi, some of your experience.
Well, in my own industry, let me tell you, we are a tier two vendor in the auto sector. That is, we supply to companies who are vendors to auto majors. In our sector, we normally get yearly orders, purchase orders that is, and monthly schedules. And more often than not, these schedules are given at the last minute. And most of the time, when the schedule comes, it comes with a tagline that we wanted this yesterday. So what we do in our industry is to, we maintain a record of the pattern of customer schedules and our dispatches. And since we are in the auto sector, we know the pattern of sales since last maybe 2-3 years. So we keep a certain quantity of items ready or near ready, in near ready condition. And second thing we do is that we try to act proactively on any customer complaint. And once a customer complaint is received, we not only rectify it, but we log it in our computers, in our systems, and track our future supplies for the same, you know, problems till that problem vanishes. And we have created a data bank where we maintain all this data so that in case that problem resurfaces, we can refer to what we did that time. And another thing which we have not yet done, but we are in advanced stage of planning, is to get one, continuous feedbacks from our customers, and two, you know, contact our customers who have been our customers, but for some reason or the other, they are not giving business to us. Because I come from a manufacturing sector, and that too an MSME, we are really at the nascent stage as far as digital technology is concerned, and this is what we have been doing. Thank you.
Thank you. So now I think last, before, if we can have some time for interaction also, in 30 seconds, if each of us can try to say, you know, what is the one message we would like to leave behind with the audience, that, you know, what is our one mantra, what one message, Sanjay?
So again, going back to the previous session, I'll give you a punchline, yeah? The only way for extreme customer centricity is deliver value. Based on the value that you have delivered, earn trust of the customer. And if you have earned that trust of the customer, you'll become an extended arm of his organization. You'll become his partner for life.
Wonderful. Yeah,
that's the punchline.
Wonderful. Mr. Umesh.
Sir, you'll have to give me just a little bit more than 30 seconds, but I'll be quick. So from my perspective, it's an urgent message. As SME, get into digital interactions. This is the time when it's a great leveler. All the big companies, right? The biggest thing that they had with them was money. It was people. Today, with digital interactions available to you very easily, agar aapke paas koi achhi cheez hai, aap bade aasani se usko customer tak pahuncha sakte hain across geographies without spending too much money. One is this. Second thing is, ke aap through digital interactions, aap aaram se customer ko service achhi de sakte hain. You have artificial chatbots in today's times. Agar aapke paas log nahi hai 24/7 service dene ke liye, aap bade aasani se at least 60-70% questions unke aise hi answer kar sakte hain jaldi se. You can reach out to people very, very quickly to be able to service them, to send reminders to them, to go ahead and acquire customers. So please do not miss this opportunity to become big. Thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Anand.
Just putting across regulatory perspective, probably we'd like to see that most of the companies who are there should be get listed. Probably they can unlock the value of the organization when they get listed. And probably we would like to see more of a corporate governance coming into the place, because when you get listed, probably the company secretary has to be there. And proper delegation of jobs should be there, because what we could really see as a promoter, if you see a SME promoter, I feel he's a director, if you look at the movie, he's like a producer, he's a director, he's an actor, he's a cinematographer for the movie, and he's doing all the things together. Probably there should be a proper structuring of the organization, having like CFO or a sales guys, and they should empower the team so that they reach out to the main goal of the organization also. That's my thing.
Thanks. Mr. Ravi.
Well, there have been lots of do's which have been stated here, but One point which has been discussed, I would like to say not only the customer centricity has to start from the top, it has to percolate down the line. And just like we have, you know, meetings and we have quality audits, we should have recent, regular reviews of what we are doing about remaining customer centric. That is due. And I just said that while, you know, too much of anything is bad. So we have to ensure that we don't overdo it. Thank you.
Optimal. Mr. Mohit.
So very quickly speaking of just a few points. First of all, every piece of your supply chain, internal and external, is a customer. So do focus on that with equal amount of passion. Secondly, if you're not working to create 200% customer delight, you're probably going to lose the battle. We are living in a hyper-connected world. A small mistake could be your last there. We all heard about the bits and pieces mistakes yesterday, and we heard how social media can amplify that. It's unforgiving. Make technology your friend. The consumers are adopting mobile, internet, et cetera, in a big way. And if you are not there in front of them, you're probably losing a chance to be there. Change your perspective. Just because you've not imagined doesn't mean it's not happening. So be open. Just because it's not been done or you do not want to be the first to do it doesn't mean that it can't be done. So, continue to get focused on the customer. And if you're focused on the customer, rest everything will follow.
Thanks. And my two bit is only, both if you look at extreme customer centricity and digital aid, both are inevitable. Please adopt it. Please follow it. Please do it. Now I think we still have around 2 minutes, so we can have some questions from audience for any of the fellow panelists.
My name is Ike Sinha. I am country director, Unite for Good. Everyone seems to be mentioning about customer care, customer centricity, but to my mind, the attention or towards the customer, there is a gap. How are the people involved to be trained to make sure at the doorstep of the customer that to derive the trust and faith that you don't lose out on them, the basic ethics, manners, discipline, work on time, this training, isn't there a system, whether it is with digital or otherwise, to train such people that they are customer friendly? You call up customer care, they are the most you call any customer care, railway onwards. Nobody cares. How do you change this attitude and the mindset?
I think it is all about change management. And change management has to happen across the organization. And sir, we have to acknowledge that I think we are in hurry. Earlier years, you know, everything, every change has taken 3 years, 5 years. Now everything happens in months. So there is a hurry in everything. So, and it is evolving. So what you're saying is right, but then I think everybody is learning, and you know, those who are not learning, they are going out of business. Anybody want to just further add to that, sir?
Yeah, so I think in the digital world, what you're saying is absolutely true. Everything is happening instantly. Some of the frustrations that you get when you pick up a phone to call somebody is all very imminent. But even if you go back to the brick and mortar world and you go back to yesteryears, you used to probably get your first chance to sell whatever you were selling, your services or your goods, through a point of contact. Somebody knew somebody and he opened the doors for you within that organization. Gone are those days. Today you do not sell through a point of contact. You sell through a point of impact. And how you're going to ensure that every single person who is representing your organization, be it at the sales of sales or be it at the sales of delivering something, is making that impact so that you're creating that within the first few minutes of your interaction with that person. And that is something that you will have to percolate across your organizations. Even if you're a 10 people company, 50 people company, or a 5,000 people company, you will have to do that. Gone are the days where you could sell from a point of contact. Today it's from a point of impact. Yeah.
Can I add something
Thanks.
To this? So, can I just add?
Yeah, please.
So I think so, it's an expectation. At one time, if we called up a customer service and we got a response in even 5 days' time, we used to be very happy because we were very happy. Then came a time when it was a very people-driven business over the call or something, where you used to wait for half an hour on a call, just waiting for somebody to pick up it if it became a problem. See, businesses understand these issues. That's the reason now you have these chatbot things that we're talking about, right? Where there's a study done, more than 65% of the questions asked by customers can be answered automatically, right? So if 65% questions are answered automatically, the interaction with humans become that much lesser, hopefully. And then the humans which are left to answer the things, they have more time to answer at a, you know, in a, at a better pace. So I think things keep improving over a period
yes.
of time. Thank you.
Thanks.
Oh, yeah, another 30 seconds. I think they've answered it very nicely. Just two things. One is a question of organizational values. And I think those values, if they're not customer-centric, no matter how much efforts you put into it, it'll never happen. And what gets measured gets done. So how do you measure customer response, customer centricity, and how does your management enforce that? That apart, I think technology today is playing a big role. Chatbots, voice bots, etc. today ensure consistency, agility in response. You call at 2 in the night, it'll still answer you with a pleasing voice. Apart from that, today technology helps you understand the tone. You know, there are voice synthesis technology which are available which help you understand what's the tone of your engagement,
sentiment
analysis, across chat, across voice, across emails, etc. I know of many use cases where customers collate through social media or direct interactions, you know, the negative engagements and respond to them first rather than the positive engagements, because that can always happen later. So there are many things which we could do on that.
Shkali, do we have another time for another question, or we are done actually? If anybody has a last question.
No, actually, it's Umesh has already spoken for me, whatever I wanted to state. That is, I think the reliance on human beings have to actually go down as far as the call centers are concerned. Because chatbots, not just 60%, actually it can be close to 100%. Because it constantly learns. Today, if a new question comes up, tomorrow when that question will be repeated, the chatbot will be able to answer it. So that kind of constant learning is expected in the future.
Thanks, sir. So thanks, my fellow panelists. Thank you very much. I think we have crossed by a couple of minutes. So for that, apologies for that. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. We'll request you to kindly remain seated for a couple of minutes, and I'll request Mr. K.K. Mohapatra to kindly come forward and present mementos. We thank you. We thank our chairperson and moderator, Mr. Sudhir Aggarwal. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, Mr. Anand Chari. Thank you very much for your precious time and sharing your stories with us. Thank you, Mr. Sanjay Hiranandani. Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable inputs. Thank you, Mr. Mohit Pande. Thank you, Mr. Ravi Sood. And thank you, Mr. Umesh Gupta. Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us. Once again, we'd like to thank our chairperson, our moderator, and our esteemed panelists here. We request you to kindly take your seats in the hall. We'll start off with our next session. Thank you very much.